The most important musical instrument. George Bernard Shaw wrote, "Its invention was to music what the printing press was to poetry." Bartolomeo Cristofori, an Italian, invented the piano at the beginning of the 18th century. Evolving from the harpsichord, the piano emerged at the dawn of the Industrial Revolution. With some 20,000 parts, the piano has been able to produce a sound that inspired the likes of Bach, Mozart, Beethoven. The piano has continued to remain one of the most valued musical instruments to this day. Century, the piano began to make its way into the roots of American music, becoming one of the key instruments in playing the blues. Piano blues could be heard in the saloons, lumber camps, brothels, churches, honky-tonks, all the way down the Mississippi to Louisiana, Alabama, and Texas. Soon it settled in New Orleans, quickly spreading to Chicago and Harlem and Kansas City. From the 1920s to the present, piano blues has remained a steadfast foundation and the fountain of American music. It has embraced boogie-woogie, jump blues, stride, gospel blues, the Spanish tinge, rhythm and blues, urban blues, and all kinds of jazz. Many piano players have made their deep mark in the blues, and this is their story.
Hey, Ray.
Hey. What's up?
Not too much.
Beer.
How you doing? Good to see you, old amigo. All the good times.
That's right. You got it, brother.
And here's to all those women.
Here's to all the women.
That we've been through.
So set them up, my amigo. Oh, man.
What got you interested in music? How did you start?
When I was 3 years old, there was a man living next door. Well, he had a like a little general store, you know, where you buy kerosene and candy and bread and stuff like that. A little small village town in Florida. Well, anyway, when I was three, I don't know why, but every time he'd start to practice, I couldn't help myself. I had to stop and listen to. And he would play that boogie woogie, you know.
And I
just loved. And I would go jump on the stool and try to hit the key. And he'd say, no. Every time, I don't care if I was playing with my buddies or whatever I was doing, when he started to play that piano, I stopped in my tracks.
Yeah.
And so eventually.
He taught you some of it?
He started, you don't hit the piano with your full fist, son. I'm going to teach you how to play a melody with one finger. And you know, that's how he did it. I started. like that. Yeah. You know, that's how I got started. And I was so fascinated. I can hit a key and make a make a sound. Or, you know, I was very impressed. I mean, you stop and think, this guy was practicing. You know, the thing is, Clint, you showed you about people, though. He could have said, get away from me, kid. Don't you see I'm practicing?
Yeah.
And I would have had to go, you know, because I was taught to mind grown people regardless, you know. But he didn't say that. He must have saw some. I guess he felt that any kid that's willing to give up his playing time, you know, to come and listen to him, he must love music. I think that's what he must have thought, you know.
Do you remember his name?
Wiley Pittman.
Wiley Pittman.
Yeah, Wiley Pittman. I'll never forget
him. And he was a boogie piano player.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, those guys were great. Well, it's funny. Almost every piano player that I talked to started out that way, listening to something like that, because that was kind of the intriguing music.
Oh, yeah, that was...
Either that or a lot of them get it in church or something. Gospel kind of players, which would play like that. I grew up with Meat Lux Lewis.
Said the same time, right?
The same time, And Albert Ammons.
That's right, there you go.
All those guys,
Well, see, those guys play the hell out of boogie. Different styles, different kinds. As time went on, you know, as I say, he started me out picking out just a little melody with one or two fingers and showing him a little bit. And I became so interested, you know, in the sound that I was creating myself. I was so fascinated with that. And then, you know, as time went on, he was able to tell me, now, you know, you got two hands. I said, yes, sir. Well, then you have to learn how to use the other hand, too. You know, it was, the man was so nice to me. I mean, the reason I appreciate him so much, because as I became a grown man, I realized the one thing that impressed me is that he didn't throw me out. He didn't say, kid, I'm practicing, get away from it. And he could have said that.
Yeah.
But he didn't.
And then and nowadays a kid would, if they start them out, they'd do CGM blues because it's the easiest.
Yeah.
That's the easiest thing to play. You play two notes.
That's it.
Two keys.
That's it.
And then you got interested in Tatum, of course.
Yeah. Well, you know, as time went on, you know, you start listening to these guys. And of course, I was being in this village. You know, I heard a lot of blues. You know, you had people like Tampere and Blind Boy Phillips.
Yeah, I listened to those guys too. Yeah.
Big Joe Turner.
Oh yeah. Oh, Big Joe Manson.
I just loved music, you know. If it sounded good, it was all right with me.
Yeah.
And of course, in the South in those days, you had two kinds of music. You had the blues in your own neighborhood, and then they had, and if you turn on the radio, you got country and western. That's it.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
My mom would let me stay up on Saturday night. That's the only time I could stay up past 9 o'clock was on Saturday night, because I loved the Grand Ole Opry.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was fascinated.
Grand Ole Opry.
Yeah.
The Ryman Auditorium?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. You got it.
Yeah, we filmed in there one time.
It was really?
Kind of a classical place, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So with this whole documentary we're doing is a sort of the history of the blues and how it started and trying to find people like yourself who, how did they get interested in it? And a lot of people say boogie woogie, like you're saying, or some kind of tunes.
But see, in the neighborhood where I was in, I mean, that's what you heard. You know, you heard the blues all the time, Muddy Waters.
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, we had T-Bone Walker. And,
yes!
Yeah,
there
and,
you go.
Joe Houston.
Come on, man. You know what's happening,
yeah,
brother.
Yeah, we had him. In fact, I was talking to Joe Adams out there, and I said, I know you. I used to listen to you on the air all the time when I was going to college down here.
Yeah, well, when I first came to California in 1949, he was a kid. Anywhere you went in the city, I don't care where it was, gas station, grocery store, anywhere. Yeah. You heard him on the radio from 12 to 3.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Never will forget that.
Yeah.
You know? Well, I'm drifting and I'm drifting. Like a ship out on the sea, well, I'm drifting and I'm drifting. Like a ship out on the sea, well, I ain't got nobody in this world to care for me. But the blues was something that it was just there. And then, of course, my mom was Baptist, so I went to church to all the revival meetings and BYPU and the Sunday morning service, the Sunday night service, and the revival meeting.
Yeah.
So, you know.
People love that music. I love that music. I used to go to them even if I wasn't a member of the church. I'd go and sit in the back.
Yeah.
Just to hear
well, see,
in
those days, they didn't have no instruments. They just walk in and you hear the preacher say, "Well, I told the Lord, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da." And then the choir starts,
Dave, and I'll just ask you a little bit about the blues. The origin in your mind, how you get interested in it, if and where, who influenced you when you were a young guy?
You know, the spirituals and the blues are all kind of connected. And I had a friend from New Orleans. And she, when there was trouble, she'd say, "Lord, Lord, what will tomorrow bring? Today, I felt an arrow stinging in a wound so deep my eyes refuse to weep. And this is the blues and kind of the spiritual.
Beautiful. Who was your biggest influence when you were young? What piano player?
Well, when I was a kid going to school, college, I got a chance to be intermission pianist for a great pianist, a woman named Cleo Brown. She's the one that gave me a note to introduce me to Art Tatum, the greatest pianist, one of the greatest musicians we've ever had.
Told a great story about Cleo Brown. Did you know Cleo Brown?
No.
But he's Cleo Brown who turned him on to Art. And once he heard Art Tatum, of course, everybody else, like Fats Waller and everybody said, that's God. You know, there.
Well, that's right. You got it.
Yeah.
But at least it was true, man. I mean, you just couldn't believe the piano's got 88 keys and he ain't got but 10 fingers.
Yeah.
I mean,
but he made it sound like
that's right. He sounded like two people playing.
Thank you.
sometimes he would have his beer with him, you know, he'd like drink that. And he's when he's taking a sip of beer, he's just his left hand.
Yeah.
You never knew the difference.
Yeah.
Didn't make no difference.
Yeah. Yeah. We were joking about it the other day. He said it had the fastest left hand in the West.
That's right. But my God, man, you know, I mean, when you just sit back and just listen to Art Taylor, you just don't believe what you're hearing. And the closest person that I've ever heard to him was Oscar Peterson.
Yeah. Can we use motherfucker on the
air? Oh.
Of course we can. So play us one of your early blues things if you want. What you grew up with or something that influenced.
Let's see.
Thank you. Nat.
Oh, Nat Cole was my
a great
man.
Player.
See, Nat, and a lot of people don't know that. They know him for his singing.
Yeah, but he's a great player.
That's right. You great got player. It. And that's what I wanted to be when I was a kid coming up. I wanted to sing and play those little tasty things behind my singing like he does. That's why I tried to imitate him, did everything that I could to say. Ate Nat King Cole, slept Nat King Cole, drank Nat King Cole, you know. Yeah.
Well, those early records of his, too, where he actually played on a, you know, later on he became such a huge singing star that he had Nelson Riddle and everybody.
But see, that's why a lot of people don't know he can play.
Yeah.
But I knew he could play, man, because I heard him when he had his first trio and the stuff, the way he put it together with the guitar and himself with the piano.
It is better to be on the shelf. Just like a hermit living in a cave. You don't get much loving, but the dough you save makes it better to be by yourself. Out, she say, I'll see you, Gate. Now he works all day and come home at night. Instead of little bitty petting, all she wants to do is fight. So it's better to be by yourself, boy. It's better to be by yourself, oh man. It's better to be by yourself, boy.
Tasty stuff.
Yeah.
But Nat Cole, don't fool yourself, my friend.
Yeah, no,
he could play.
He could play.
And with feeling.
See,
you know, it's not just running up and down the keyboard, it's playing with feeling, man, and knowing what you're doing. Baby, let me hold your hand.
Piano players out of New Orleans have been continuous contributors to the world of the blues. From its first hero, Jelly Roll Morton, Professor Longhair, Fats Domino, Dr. John, the celebratory sound emanating from New Orleans is a joy to behold.
Tell me, who was your first influence?
Well, when I was a little weed hop, my aunt Andre taught me how to play the Texas boogie.
The Texas boogie?
And as a little kid, I used to do that.
Yeah.
But you know, I learned how to put the whole thing together later. But I tell you, the guy that I like, was like Pete Johnson when he was old records with Joe Turner. Stuff like that.
Rolling Pete
kid.
And all that,
I liked that, was it Piney Brown? That was one of the little kids I remember that. And I liked, local artists in New Orleans, like Chip and Jack Dupree. I loved to hear him play the Junkie Blues. I mean, that was kind of, you know, when all them local cats would be doing that whole little style of that was a whole part of New Orleans. Yeah. And it was cats played the very same thing with a whole other bag. And I got to hear a lot of those cats as a kid. So that's what made me want to be a guitar player.
Yeah. So
Damn, it was a cat. Like, he used to play the jungle. It was like. Them styles, it was all like the same thing. You know, yeah. It was all junky blues.
But why did you want to be a guitar player?
I heard so many bad piano players.
Yeah.
I just decided I'll never get a job playing music as a piano player. There was so many cats. It was, like I said, it was the champion, Jack Dupree. It was Huey Smith. Even he got famous for doing all of the rock and ammonia and boogie woogie flute and all that stuff later. When I first remember him, he was playing the blues and it was bad stuff, you know.
I mean, you mean bad being good?
I mean
bad.
Seriously hip stuff.
Bad,
you know?
Meaning good.
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
You know, the thing that it was, Professor Longhead was one of my all-time heroes back as a kid. I got to meet him as a little kid because my father was not only selling records but fixing. Like PA systems and stuff around town, so.
Yeah. He used to take old pianos like this one, when they couldn't really, you know, put them together, they'd set them out on the street. The trash could pick them up. And we'd drag them in the house or in the alleys in different places. And I learned how to fix pianos this way. I mean, what didn't play, I'd get hammers off of one piano and put them in the other, and get the little pads that make the action down here. If it wouldn't work, I'd tie a chord string or thread in it and bring it up to the next notch and tie it in where the action would work, you know. So I got them to play some keys with it and some didn't, you know. But just with a broken piano that I had in the house, he taught me a lot. This is why I learned how to start cross-cording piano. If he didn't play, it didn't matter to me. I'd find some other key to substitute, you know.
Besides your, was it all in the family, your aunt, mother?
To start with.
Yeah.
And then I grew up in blues country, and I had piano players in my family. So first, my grandmother, who played ragtime piano, was an influence on me. She had a pile of Tin Pan Alley sheet music.
Yeah.
So I got to hear a lot of that. my aunt played beautiful piano and played a certain amount of boogie-woogie.
Uh-huh.
So as I started exploring piano, really, Professor Longhair uh-huh. and the New Orleans uh-huh. style uh-huh. Of playing, but his in particular, because he was such an innovator. He invented and created that polyrhythmic style that that so many of us do, and yeah. it carried on through Dr. John and James Booker, yeah. And now a whole other generation.
Well, give us a little shot of what your
favorite. Well, my favorite Fest kind of stuff.
Playing stuff that made him famous, and he yeah. was playing the blues.
Yeah.
Domino's amazing. One time we took him out on the plains of the Grand Tetons in Wyoming, and we put a huge grand piano out there and had Fats Domino play. And so he started playing one of these things, I Want to Walk You Home, or one of these songs. And all of a sudden everyone stopped and they looked over the side of the hill, and there was about 10 elk, and they were all sitting there with their heads tilted like this. And as soon as he stopped playing, they left. But they were fascinated. So everybody likes the blues.
I was going to say, no critics there. Huh?
Thank you. gimmick.
Think the blues sort of evolved from? What do you think was the beginning? You think it was out of gospel, out of churches and stuff like that?
I tell you, I think about what Muddy says about it. The blues had a baby in their name in the rock and roll.
About things that gives the name the blues. He got no bread and love sick.
And a mule, Mr. Mate.
That's two blues in the
world.
I would do the same thing because I know all of the concern what you're talking about. I would say, if time don't get no better, up the road I'm going. The blues, you're like a doctor, you know. It can heal you, and it can pull you down in some way. Really, what we get all our blues from mostly is our beautiful ladies.
Yeah.
Yeah. That ain't
yeah, man.
Let me tell you something.
In the 1950s, an urban blues sound came together in Chicago. Men like Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf electrified the music that had been brought up from the Delta. Contributing to this life force of deep blues were piano players like Otis Spann.
me tell you something now. One day, I have a turkey, and the next day, ain't nothing shake, ain't nobody's business. You hear me? What I do. Me and my baby, we fuss and fight just the next morning. Child, we was all right. Ain't no bad. How much you ever do? Take a notion, go right down, now jump in the ocean. Ain't no bad business, I'm with you. Yep, I do.
I got a lot of influence from her because I couldn't play the blues in my daddy's house.
Yeah.
See, my mother was the mother's church, my dad was deacon of church.
Oh, I see.
And I couldn't play no blues, but I had to go to her house to play the blues. See.
To sneak out, yeah.
But well, I got quite a few whoopings behind it, too.
Yeah.
I was supposed to be in school and I wasn't.
Yeah.
I was playing the blues.
Very much influenced by blues, but then before that, it seems like music in rock and roll is getting less complicated, where blues was more gospel, had more soul to it.
Yes, well, you know, I never did draw any difference between blues and any of that stuff.
Yeah,
I thought it was all related, like maybe first cousin, second cousin, sure, third cousin.
And all those jump blues guys, they were sort of like rockers, Joe Houston, all those guys.
Yeah, the jump blues guys, yeah. And they every once in a while, they veer off a little bit and go into what they call jazz.
Yeah.
That's what we call jazz back in them days, you know.
Yeah.
They'd go into jazz, you know. And so that way that I never did know what it meant to say this was that, and that was that.
Yeah, everybody tried to play everything.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I just made it one thing
and
tried to say, well, you say, oh, just the blues. Mm-hmm. Well, it could be a fast blues, slow blues.
Yeah,
so
that's
the only difference I knew, slow, fast.
Yeah, yeah, what's the tempo you're playing it in and let it go. Yeah.
Right.
Thanks very much, Jay.
Thank you.
Thanks for talking a little bit about your life and blues.
And that was splendid. She called me her lover and called me her beggar, too. I know those words. I've used them many times.
Yeah.
Piano blues embraces all modes of jazz. The solitary player in a nightclub, the sophistication of Duke Ellington, and the energy of bebop. The blues is the basis of everything.
So, Pete, tell me how you started out.
My father brought home these records of, like, Mean Lux Lewis and Albert Ammons, and that turned me on immediately. It seems like I had, you know, a natural ability to improvise for some odd reason. It's just like a gift, you know.
Yeah.
I don't, you know, people say, how do you play jazz? I said, well, you learn how to play your instrument, and then if your fingers go there, whatever you hear,
yeah,
comes out.
Yeah, exactly. Did you learn by reading, or did you just sort of imitate?
Well, I imitated the records, and then I took piano lessons.
I always felt that jazz and blues were a true American art form, maybe the only real original American art form that we have. I just always have been fascinated with the music. I grew up listening to that rather than listening to pop tunes. And so my mother thought I was kind of crazy. That was her fault, though, because she brought home a bunch of Fats Waller records and said, now this is what I call real piano playing. And I thought, well, that's the way it is. So I tried to play a little stride piano, but it didn't come out very stridey. So I kind of ended up playing a three-chord, eight-beat thing. But I've always been interested in it, and then later on in jazz and bebop. Society sort of dictates what people start playing just by, like bebop in the 40s, it came out of people searching for something new, some new way to go after things.
Oh, yeah, you know, they had to open up some doors, you know. It's like everybody, it's like if you listen to some of the things, whatever, just, there are little things. Mm-hmm. There's something else in Salt Peanut.
Yeah.
That there was something in there that's, if you listen at it and slow it down a little bit, I forget one of the opening lines, and I can't think of it right now, but it's like, it's really sound like something Louis Armstrong played way back in the game, like one of them call thing. Mm-hmm. But beside that little famous melody of that piece,
yeah,
when Bird and this voice, because that, you heard, I mean, to me, it just, wow, they took something that, and they took it in a whole other place, and then they kept rolling with stuff like that. First time I heard a Thelonious Monk record, I thought he was a local cat. The Art Blakey playing that on. I didn't know Monk was from Carolina. He just heard music and it reminded me of stuff I heard.
Well, everybody's influenced from somewhere.
Like when we did the very last record he did, and he says, you know, play me some old, this old tune. It's an old Cousin Joe song, a guy from New Orleans that always told me he recorded in New Orleans with all these bebop cats, and I thought he was jiving me. The fact is, I remember this line out the song, I didn't even know the words, but I knew what song it came out of, but it ended with a if you get your hands on some money, get a guy and buy everything you can get. If you get your hands on some money, better go out and buy everything you can get. You know you can't take it with you. I ain't never seen an army car file a funeral yet. That line though, I never seen an army car file a funeral.
You want to play a little of Pine Top's Boogie for us?
Well, I tell you, I can't play it like I used to because I got stabbed in this arm here and I can't get the bass running like I want to.
Yeah.
I just do the
best
I can.
Well, I can't play it like I used to, and I didn't even get stabbed.
Man, I used to play that thing, man. Oh.
Give us just a little taste of something.
See you.
Joy, sorrow, happiness, despair, and truth in a timeless fashion. Thank you.
that's all right, man.
Even patriotic songs can become the blues.
Sing these words. Oh, beautiful. Ah, spacious skies. Amber waves of rain. Purple America, America. Well, God set his grace on me. Oh, yes, he did, and he called that girl. Oh, don't you remember? Said the brotherhood. From sea to shining sea. You know, y'all can just hum a little bit longer when it's all right. America, oh, how I love you, America. Well, my God, he not said his grace on me. He told me it would. Should be brotherhood. Come on, see to try to see. Oh. Yeah, Jesus. I want to thank you, Lord.
Clássicos apresenta concerto exclusivo da Oslo Camerata, daqui a pouco, 11 da noite. Assista agora Entre Linhas e logo após, Café Filosófico.